look today, the endocrine system controls and coordinates body functions through glands that secrete hormones, which are chemicals, into the bloodstream and distribute them, those hormones, throughout the whole body. So they find receptors that are on cells that then alter their function. So this is something like you eat a sugary meal and have a lot of sugar in the bloodstream, and the pancreas will secrete insulin into this bloodstream, and the insulin will go to the cells of the body and tell the cells to take the glucose in. And so that's what that does. So this system is very similar to the nervous system, and we'll do that, and then we have the skin in between, and then we'll get to the nervous system. But the system of the endocrine system and the nervous system, they both control body function. Okay, so they're doing that. In a very similar way, actually. We'll get to see that in a minute. We're gonna differentiate between endocrine glands and exocrine glands. Exocrine glands is the sweaty stuff, and endocrine glands secrete the hormones into the bloodstream, so we'll differentiate those. And then we'll look at how they work on, how different hormones work on different body functions, and what do they influence. So let's just go right into it. So this terminology here, the control and coordinate function of cells and organs throughout the body, that is definitely very important. So it controls it, and it also coordinates between the different cells. We have glands in the endocrine system. So you have classic glands like the thymus gland, like the thyroid gland, like not the thymus, the thyroid gland, the pancreas, the adrenal gland, all that kind of stuff. That's the glands. And they secrete chemical signaling agents, which we call hormones, and they secrete that specifically into the bloodstream. And so these little hormones, these little dots, go through the bloodstream, and at some point they're going to find a cell which has a receptor. The receptor is this thing right here that fits exactly into this very, very specific hormone. So for example, insulin will go to the receptors that open, that let the glucose into them. They open channels that let glucose come in. Insulin is not gonna go to a receptor that's gonna do other things. It's just gonna specifically do that thing only. And the control of that is the receptor itself. The receptor determines which hormone does it let talk to it, which hormone can talk to it. And so it's very, very specific, this system. It has to be. You cannot have it generally. You put insulin in and all kind of stuff starts working. That's not going to work. It's got to be very, very specific. And the specificity is between the hormone and the receptor, but the receptor is really the one that determines it, because the receptor has to be put onto the cell. And so if this is a cell that does not need to be influenced by this hormone, there would not be a receptor. So the amount of receptors is really determining how great is that function on that particular cell. And so we call the cells with hormone, with receptors on them, that the hormone can talk to, we call them target cells. So the hormone targets those cells. The hormone alone is not going to do nothing. The hormone is just the voice. That then the receptor is going to do something onto the cell. Okay, exocrine glands secrete their substances like directly via ducts to the external surface and also the internal body surface. So the difference is exo and endo. Exo comes from the word exit. Crine just means gland. Crine means gland. And so exocrine glands, this is an exocrine gland. This is a skin surface here, and this is, let's say it's a sweat gland or something. it secretes its substances to the outside body, to up here, or also to the inside part that has connections to the outside, like the gut tube. So that would be the internal body surfaces. As an example, that's the gut tube. There we go, gut tube. And so those are the same as this skin thing. Okay?
Good.
Oh, here's the slide with that. The endocrine system is closely related to the nervous system, as they both control and coordinate cellular function. Nerves use electricity. Have you ever hit your funny bone here?
Yeah.
And it goes ooh and shoots down? That's the electricity, what you feel. If you haven't, just bang real hard, you'll feel it. No, don't. So the nerves use electricity to transmit their messages through the body. That is fast. Electricity, we consider that being fast. So those hormones, that system works very fast. Whereas the hormones have to travel through blood. And that's like a river. That's like, that takes a time. And so the bloodstream is much slower, and so the endocrine glands act much slower than the nerves. But once you set these hormones into the bloodstream, their effects will be longer lasting than the nervous effects. So the nerves do control the body function quickly and fast, but they dissipate pretty fast too. So the good example of that is like you're driving down the freeway, la la la, listening to some good music, and all of a sudden some friggin', I don't know, maybe you're listening to rap or something, you go like jerks in front of you and you have to swerve out of the way and you curse in the storm, but you curse off the storm after you swerved out of the way and you didn't have the accident. That's the nervous system that works so fast to make you be able to swerve out of the way. You didn't, huh? Well, that's true, huh? And so that's the electricity. No, that's fast. By the time you recognize it, it's gone. And then you keep driving, and then you curse, right? And you're like, what? And then about half a minute later, you start having the jitters. It's like, God, why do I feel like I had some coffee? And you're all like shaky, and it's like, no, you know, how you have that feeling sometimes when some shocky things happen. Well, that's the adrenaline, and that's a hormone. So that's the delay of slow between the swerving and you feeling jittery. That sort of gives you an idea. It's not really that slow. It's just a little bit slower than the nerves. That's usually the example I use to feel the difference between a nervous function and a hormonal function. So we use the hormones that act slower and longer for more ongoing processes in the body, such as growth, reproduction, metabolic processes like bringing the sugar into the gland, the metabolic rate, how fast the chemical reactions happen in the body. That's the thyroid gland that helps with that. So that's a metabolic hormone. Sometimes people, if they can't lose weight, they have a problem with the thyroid. So that's a very important gland to check if you can't lose weight. And both of these systems, the nervous system and the endocrine system, they are here to adapt the body to a constantly changing surrounding and stresses of the surrounding. Constantly changing. Like he's finding the knot there. So I like this, kind of like nervous system versus endocrine system is a fast system, it's a slow system. But the nervous system, I didn't tell you that yet. The nervous system, let's say a nerve impulse comes from here and tells me to control this muscle here. That's the nervous system, telling the muscles to do something, to work. So the electricity goes from here all the way down to the arm, to the muscle, and then at the muscle level, where the nerve stops, there is actually a chemical released, a neurotransmitter it's called. Like, have you ever heard of Botox?
Yeah.
That's a neurotoxin that diminishes the function of the nerve, so you can't frown all the time. So you don't get all pissy all the time. And so that changes, that that works against that chemical that is making the muscle react. And so that's why they squirt it in there. Sometimes they put it in the neck for real bad migraines and headaches. And sometimes that works. But a chemical is what talks from the nerve to the muscle and makes the muscle contract. The nerve electricity goes from the nerve, from the brain to the place where the chemical is released. So most nerves don't go like, they don't go to a muscle and they electrocute the muscle all the time. The electricity stops before that. So here you got the electricity and here you got the bloodstream. But you both influence what happens with the chemical. In the endocrine system is called a hormone, in the nervous system is called a neurotransmitter. And then here it just says it's short and quick and brief results, and this is a long-term situation. So that's about all we talked about that. So I like that thing. Hormones are chemical molecules that bind to specific receptors on the target and then alter their activity of that cell. Sensitivity of a cell to a hormone depends on the number of available receptors. So if you do not have receptors, the hormone can't talk to you as a cell. But if you want to have that cell react really strongly to a specific hormone, we'll put a lot of receptors there, so a lot of these hormones attached to it, and that is a stronger reaction. Biochemically speaking, hormones can be divided into lipophilic or hydrophilic. Lipophilic is like the same as hydrophobic. Remember hydrophobic? The oil, the fat. So some hormones are fatty hormone based. And then some hormones are watery based. The hydro means water. Philic means loving. So you've got a hydro loving thing. Well, that should be a heart. I guess that's not a heart. So the lipophilic hormones in endocrine system, they call it lipophilic, not hydrophobic. But they, what they can do is they can penetrate the cell membrane straight. Because the cell membrane is an oil film, and oil can go through oil. Water cannot go through oil, it's going to be pushed away, rejected. So the hormones that are water-based are going to go, oh, we can't get in there. So for them, the receptor is always on the outside. And then the receptor translates the message to the inside, and something happens. Very often it goes to the nucleus, and it makes some proteins, some enzymes, and changes the function of that. The steroid hormone, hydrophobic or lipophilic hormones, philic, hydrophobic, are also known as steroid hormones. The foundation of a lot of those hormones is cholesterol. Now that's interesting when we want to get rid of that cholesterol. We need cholesterol to make hormones. And so those steroids, they go straight through. They penetrate the cell membrane and their receptors usually on the inside of the cell. So hydrophobic hormones bind to a receptor on the cell surface, which then start a chain reaction into the cell membrane before triggering a second messenger. That's another term that I didn't mention. So for example, this is hydrophilic. Receptors out here, hormone gets onto it, and then there's some reaction, and then on the inside, this is the secondary messenger. On the inside, there is some change happening, and then that will be the one that talks to the cell and makes the change. So that's why they call them an outer messenger. You don't have to go that deep with that, but once you do Bio-20AB or Bio-4, you talk more about this and have specific patterns that they go down to. I know. Lipophilic hormone can penetrate the cell membrane and bind to receptors in the cytoplasm, that's inside of the cell. And often the hormone receptor complex then migrates to the nucleus and activates a gene initiating a protein synthesis. So that's often what happens is we make enzymes are protein. Add protein. Like growth hormone, you make more muscle, more bone. for example. That's the one that, you know, makes us grow. An ongoing process. Growth is an ongoing process. You would drive yourself bonkers if the growth would be done by nervous impulses all the time. That would be way too complex. So, well, since hormones are very delicate chemicals with very strong reactions, I mean, you just have a few little drops and they do the work on the whole body, they need to be really, really well controlled because they can get out of hand and we don't want that. So, when we look at the control, we first have to understand that we here talk about classic, so it's called classic endocrine glands, which only work with hormone secretion. We also learn over the decades that many glands in the body, many organs in the body have endocrine function too. They secrete hormones too. The lungs secrete hormones, the heart secrete hormones. The muscles, when you use muscles, they secrete a hormone called myokine. And that hormone goes through the body and does all the good stuff. Decreases blood pressure, changes the sugar handling, all the stuff that's chronic pathology. When we don't use muscle tissue, they're gonna get sluggish and they secrete another hormone called myostatin. And myostatin does all the bad stuff. All the blood pressure go up, the diabetes, the sugar handling is not as efficient and all that sort of stuff. And that's one of the reasons why we wanna be active. And you know, take a walk and contract those puppies once in a while. But the muscle, we don't think of a muscle as being a gland. The muscle is a muscle, it contracts. So here we talk about the so-called classic glands that only do hormone secretion. And hormone secretion is largely regulated via the negative feedback mechanism. Ah, you're coming back. You remember that thing? The teeter-totter thing? It gets too hot, the body needs to sweat, so we get cold. It gets too cold, the body needs to shiver, so we get warmer. So negative means we want to do the opposite. So in this situation, we can measure blood levels of, let's say, calcium or glucose from all the substances we want. We can measure that by a receptor, a chemoreceptor to be precise. And then when that chemoreceptor talks to the specific gland, let's say it's like, oh, glucose is low, or let's say glucose is high, and we need to get the gland to secrete insulin so the glucose sugar level can come down. So it's the opposite function. If it's high, we want it down. If it's low, we want it up. And so we either release more hormones depending, or we inhibit the release. Let's say you have a whole bunch of sugar in the blood and you secrete insulin, and then all of a sudden the sugar drops and you have nothing in there. You want to stop that insulin at that point. You want to inhibit that because the chemoreceptor will pick up. It's like there's no more glucose here. Okay. Many of the receptors are located in the brain, specifically the hypothalamus. That's somewhere middle, inside there, deep. Like in between in the temple, somewhere in there, somewhere in the middle. That's where the hypothalamus is. And then the hypothalamus is a really cool thing, actually, the hypothalamus. Sends hormones to the pituitary gland. And the pituitary gland is this little thing right here in the middle of the brain, but it reaches down a little bit because it's really actually a problem because brain, it's very soft, and glandular tissue is very fast growing. And so you can grow a gland and it kind of compress the brain structure because the gland doesn't, you know, it's gonna be just smooshing it. It's much stronger. And so this gland sits in the cella turcica. Remember the cella turcica inside the brain? That's why there's so much bone there, it's enclosed in there, so it cannot grow. It stays its own size. And then the pituitary gland often goes and influences peripheral glands in the tissues, like the thyroid gland or the adrenal gland. So the control often then is from the brain inside the hypothalamus, that's brain, to the pituitary gland, which is the first gland, and then from there to the rest of the body. So it's almost like you've got a three-tier control system here. So that's kind of helpful to understand, or for the system not to work out of whack. But the other thing is, this gives the brain the overriding organizational control of the endocrine system. So this is one of the fundamental bases why we can influence with mind, we can influence our body. Or, of course, why the other way, why psychological stress creates somatic outcomes and creates problems in the body, in the soma. And so we have, and that's probably why, to me, psychology is one of the holy grails in medicine, because the medicine has not dealt well with psychological problems, not with anxiety and all that kind of stuff. And who does not have any of these kind of weird things? I have all of that. A lot of us do. And psychology has only been with, like, you schizophrenia and this kind of stuff. And in the old school with medicine, they didn't even touch on that. And now more and more we deal with it and with great results. I just heard an article on NPR about high blood pressure, how they have found that the psychological state of a person has a huge amount to do with their blood pressure. 10 years ago, 15 years ago, you would have told that to an MD, they go like, what's wrong with you? Maybe 20 years ago, but and we're not saying every MD, but the system itself did not pay attention to it. So I think we're lagging behind heavily on treating mental health issues, or mental health as a whole, not issues, just us regular people who deal with anxiety and deal with depression a little here and there, you know? We often just don't touch on that. And this is why that can influence the body and give you trouble in the body, give you an ulcer, give you high blood pressure and all of that. Oh, I was happy when I heard that. Because I'm reading a book by Dean Ornish, who is a cardiologist who has been able to get his program, his preventative program for heart disease, approved by Medicare. So that means a Medicare approved something other than taking pills. And that's pretty good. And so he had to be very, very thorough with his research. He started in 1975. And he talks a lot about high blood pressure and psychology and mental health and does mindfulness trainings and all that kind of stuff. And so we know it works. So this is a chart that shows us a little bit. That's a lot of confusing looking, huh? What the hypothalamus in the brain here controls. And we call the hypothalamus the master. And from the hypothalamus, we go to the pituitary gland, and that's the pituitary gland. And the pituitary gland has a front portion and it has a back portion. Anterior and posterior pituitary gland. And so now let's see, direct control by nervous system, direct release of hormones. So let's see, now the hypothalamus picks up some chemicals and says, whoa, we got a problem with this or that. And then it directly communicates to the pituitary, actually with hormones itself. And it's a small little circulation system up there in the brain. And then from there, the pituitary has all these glands it sends stuff to. It's got the adrenal gland on top of the kidneys. It's got the thyroid gland. We got, you know, these are muscle bones. I talked about that. Mammary glands. We got the testicle, the ovaries. We got the uterus, and we got the prostate, and we got the kidneys themselves. All of those hormones are secreted by this gland. And so the front hormones that are going to the front here, the control of the anterior pituitary, is controlled via hormones from the hypothalamus. But actually what I need to say is a couple of hormones the hypothalamus actually makes as hormones and brings it down to the pituitary gland, and then the pituitary gland secretes it and releases it. So some of the hypothalamus is a gland that makes hormones, and some of the hypothalamus is just here to control the anterior pituitary. Then the anterior pituitary makes its hormones to get out into the system. That wasn't explained too well. So let's try that again. Let's take a different angle here. When we look at the pituitary, we said it's the cellatursica where it's sitting in the sphenoid bone. And it's got that posterior lobe, and it's got the anterior lobe. And the posterior lobe is known also as the neurohypophysis. Need a massage. I don't know, right? I'll pick all that up. Hypophysis is an old name for pituitary gland. And so neurohypophysis is the part, the posterior part, and we name that part the one that has hormones created in the hypothalamus in the brain, and they are dropped down to the pituitary, and from there they go into the bloodstream. And we got two hormones that come from there. We got the ADH, which is known as antidiuretic hormone, or also known as the anti-P hormone. Antidiuretic means you don't pee. Diuresis is peeing. The anti of that is meaning you don't do that. So it reabsorbs water in the kidneys, a specific place to collect the tubules in the kidneys, and that raises blood volume and can influence blood pressure. So sometimes that hormone is also known as vasopressin. Vaso refers to blood vessel, pressin is pressing on it. That's an old name. Then the other hormone that's directly secreted from the hypothalamus and let out into the system by the neurohypophysis is oxytocin. And oxytocin promotes uterine contractions. You probably know that from labor, that hormone, oxytocin. And also milk ejection during breastfeeding. You know that as the letdown mechanism. And it plays a role in sexual arousal and orgasm and is responsible for feeling of sexual satisfaction. So we call that the couple hormone. So that's a very important hormone, oxytocin. Uh-oh, running out of battery here. And then the anterior side, the anterior, the front side of the pituitary is also known as the adenohypophysis. Adeno means gland. And it is made of glandular epithelial cells. And the hypothalamus controls that gland, or the cells in that gland that secrete specific hormones, via a hormone that's known as a releasing or a liberating hormone. So let's say we need more growth going on in the body. So that the hypothalamus gives us some liberant, some releasing hormones, and tell the anterior pituitary better go secrete some growth hormones now. Or we're like 7 feet tall or something, we're gonna stop growing. And then it has inhibiting hormones or statins, as in static, as in standing still. And then it tells the anterior pituitary, you better stop getting that growth hormone out there. So we stop growing. And so that's how that works. So the hypothalamus has the releasing hormones to turn the stuff on and the inhibiting hormone to turn the pituitary gland off. So now let's go through the different glands, the different hormones that anterior pituitary secretes. It's growth hormone, that's one of them. So that growth hormone increases cell size and division. It targets muscle and it targets bones. But that's gonna make us grow. Prolactin stimulates, look at that word, pro means before, and lactin is lactate, that's milk stuff. Stimulates cell division and secretion of milk in the mammary glands. It seems to enhance testosterone production in the males. So there's the name for it, prolactin. And then we're not there so far. follicle-stimulating hormone, or FSA, and luteinizing hormones, and they both go and act in the gonads. That's the testicles and the ovaries. The follicle-stimulating hormone stimulates the maturation of a follicle in an ovary and promotes also sperm production in males. So the terms come from the ovary. The follicle helps grow the follicle, which has the egg in that, that makes that mature, which then can be fertilized potentially. And in the guys, it helps with the sperm production. And the luteinizing hormone initiates ovulation in the women and enhances testosterone in the male. That's what it does there. So you got a few pictures of those things, and you also got a list here of the endocrine glands, what the FSH and the LH do. We're still working on the anterior pituitary gland, what that does, okay? So it does the adrenocorticotropic, now that's a good name, hormone enhances the secretion of the adrenal cortex hormones. So you got the kidneys, and on top of the kidneys, where's the kidney? There's no kidney. On top of the kidney sits this adrenal gland. And the adrenal gland has an outside portion called the cortex, like in the spleen, the cortex, and an inside portion of what we call the medulla. And the adrenocorticotropic hormone, adreno means adrenal gland, cortico refers to cortex, and tropic means it enhances things, I think. But that ACTH enhances the hormones that come up from the cortex of the adrenal gland. And we're gonna go through those in a minute. Well, actually, cortisol is a big one. Cortisol is a long-term stress hormone. So if you're always stressed out and stressed out and stressed out, long-term, cortisol comes into play. And cortisol does a whole bunch of stuff. Well, if you get an injection, it's cortisone. It's for pain, for inflammation. So it decreases inflammation. It makes us move faster, longer, because it's a stress hormone. It needs to keep us moving. But it also means it wears us out. It doesn't recover. It's got to recover. And if you always have cortisone in it or cortisol in it, we don't have as much recovery. It decreases the immune system too potentially if it's used too much. That's in cortisol, and it's artificially used. That becomes very important or problematic. And sometimes when we're in the 40s, and so this is also a hormone that can be make it hard to lose weight. Because the cortisol holds on to all the energy it can because it's in a danger time. It's in a fight or flight sort of feeling. And then one more hormone that comes from the adrenal hypothesis, the front part of the pituitary gland, is the thyroid stimulating hormone. And that helps the thyroid gland secrete thyroxin into the bloodstream, and that thyroxine helps with metabolism, you know, how fast do we process the sugar and how much ATP we make, or how fast we are, or how sluggish we are. Sometimes when somebody's really hyper and has eyes that are deep in the socket, they have too much of that thyroxine in the system. And often though, it's not functioning enough. And then one of the side effects is gaining weight. Good, so that's the hormones that come from the pituitary gland. Now, for testing purposes, you remember I have a test review, and we probably have more. And you only study the stuff really that's on the test review, so you don't go bazonkers and study too much. It's not too much stuff, but it's a lot if you study everything. Because we keep going until the end. We've got many chapters coming. Two booklets are coming. All right, so from then we move away from the pituitary gland and we go into a gland called the pineal gland. And the pineal gland is also known as the third eye. So when you meditate, it's like right in here deep inside somewhere. It's close to the hypothalamus, really. It secretes melatonin, and that's a serotonin derivative. And that regulates day and night rhythm. aiding our sleep. That's why people take melatonin supplements to fall asleep. Now, what you do is when you take melatonin to fall asleep is you're dumping the hormone into the system artificially. And that's great because you may be able to change your jet lag or stuff like that. But long term, it's gonna tell the pineal gland not to make the hormone because we don't need to, it's already there. And so they say, don't take serotonin, melatonin long term, take it and then have a break, and then take it and have a break, and, you know, intermittent, so the pineal gland doesn't wanna stop working. Its formation is dependent on light with increased production, with increased production when it's dark. So when the pineal gland responds to light and no light from the outside. So of course it does that through the eyeball somehow. Also season of the year influence production of that. That's the biological clock. And so sometimes we feel different in different parts of the year. Melatonin is very high in children, and that in children inhibits sexual maturation. Well, that's good. It's also a very, very strong antioxidant, eliminating damaging oxygen radicals and therefore strengthening the immune system, preventing cardiovascular disease, cancer. In particular, it seems to protect the DNA. So that's some good stuff. Pineal gland. We like the pineal gland. And I like this particularly, you know, when you look like the hieroglyphic, the hieroglyph, whatever, the Egyptian writing style. I can say it in German. But that is, they think that's the pineal gland. What they became with that. All right, that brings us to the thyroid gland. The thyroid gland is right here in the front, below the larynx in the front of the neck. It has two lobes that are connected by a stalk, and that's called the isthmus. So it's got a lobe here, it's got a lobe here, and then the stalk is in between. Internally, it's divided into lobules that are composed of tubular spaces. So those are called follicles. So when you take a cross section, the tubes just become lakes, right? Because it's two dimensional. So that's a follicle right here. And on the outside, we got these follicular cells. And thyroid hormone is secreted into the follicle, into that space by those cells, and then released when the hormone is triggering it, and it goes, you know, from there, then the hormone goes into the bloodstream. So we have the adrenocorticotrophic hormone is the hormone that's stimulating the release of thyroxine, and then thyroxine goes into the bloodstream. They have a T4 and a T3. Thyroxine has iodine on it, which is the reason why they iodinize the blood. I mean, the salt. Because iron deficiency used to give us an ineffective thyroid gland, and the body then has not enough thyroxine in the system that it can use, and it keeps making that gland bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, thinking it's doing some good, but it's useless thyroxine, and that's a goiter. Sometimes in the older people, you still see like a goiter right in here, so like an outgrowth. But since they put iodine in the salt, we don't have that problem anymore. So that's why they put iodine into the salt. Now you know. So don't get uniodized salt. Okay, TH stimulates the enzymes concerned with energy production. That's glucose oxidation in most body cells. It increases the basic metabolic rate and also body heat. And therefore, it has a calorigenic effect. It burns calories. So if that's sluggish, that could be a problem of not being able to lose weight, especially in our 40s and beyond. Then the thyroid gland has on its backside another gland. It's known as the parathyroid gland. These little dots here in the back, these are the parathyroid glands. Also, the follicles are here, the follicular cells, but then in between them, We have some other cells, parafollicular cells, next to the follicle cells. Para means next to. And those are also known as C cells, and they secrete calcitonin. And calcitonin is a hormone that reduces the blood calcium level and promotes bone formation. There's so much calcium in the bone, so if you take the blood, the calcium out of the blood, you put it in the bone. And so that's calcitonin, that's secreted by these parafollicular cells. And then these glands in the back, these parathyroid glands, are lentil-shaped epithelial cell clusters in the posterior side, and they stimulate osteoclasts to break down bone tissue and release calcium into the blood. So those two work opposing each other. One raises the blood calcium level up, the other one drops it. You need calcium for a lot of stuff. You want to be really sure that the blood level of calcium is very, very the same all the time. And so the way I remember that, I remember parathyroid and calcitonin. Where's that? Parathyroid hormone and calcitonin. And they both work with calcium in the blood. And then I remember that the calcitonin is the one that calcitonin tones the blood calcium level down. That's how I remember which one is which. Calcitonin tones it down, and then the other one brings it up. Because for some reason that didn't ever stick in my head at first. It took a while. Which one is which? Oh, and they actually figured out these glands because they used to take out thyroid glands in people and those people die. It's like, why? Because if you don't have calcium levels right in the blood, you're not going to make it. And then at some point they looked a little closer and they realized there's something else there, and that was the lentils in the back. I know. I'm sure something was still getting awkward like that. And then that's just a nice little slide showing you what happens. Remember that word, homeostasis? Stay the inside environment stays the same. And so if the calcium levels are too high, we're gonna decrease it with calcitonin. If they're too low, we're gonna increase it with the parathyroid hormones. And that's also cool because that shows you what happens. You go into the bone, you go to the gut, and you go to the kidneys, where you can regulate the calcium. Cool stuff. Then the adrenal gland. The adrenal gland is located on top of each kidney. It consists of an outer thicker cortex. So when we cut it in half, this here is the outside, is the cortex. That's actually the outside. This yellow is the shell. So that's the cortex. And then on the inside is a medulla. That little sliver here, that's the medulla on the inside. Right in here. The cortex has multiple different zones or layers. Three, actually, that we were talking about. It's got one that secretes aldosterone, and aldosterone influences water balance. So this is the second hormone we have with water balance. One is the ADH already, the antidiuretic hormone, the anti-pee hormone. And then aldosterone also works with water, but it works with reabsorbing sodium in the kidneys. And remember, water follows sodium. That's the salt of the tomato and the water droplet comes out. So if you reabsorb sodium into the bloodstream, the water will follow in with it. So that's kind of cool. That's aldosterone. And then the zona fasciculata is the next one. We don't need to worry about which zone is what called. But that's where we get that cortisol release. And we just talked about the cortisol a little bit, the previous slide. That's a long-term physical stress hormone, and it makes sure the cell's energy level, the glucose level, are maintained. It also reduces inflammation. That's why we like it as an injection in cortisone. But it decreases blood levels and activity of white blood cells. So that means it inhibits the immune system a little bit. So we want to be careful about that. So that's why they say don't do too many cortisone shots. And that's why I'm going like, you're 35 and you had what? We keep that up till we're 60 and 70. That's the way I look at it. Unless it's, really out of hand. But I had a guy, and he had multiple, like 20 or so, really a lot, cortisone shots in him. When I worked on his spine, it felt like I'm working on glass. It was so brittle, the bone. And he was like 45 or something. I was like, Jesus Christ. Everything with care, you know, and gentle. Not too gruff. We use sledgehammers a lot to create results, and we have to be careful with that. Everything has a reaction. Not all reactions are desired. And in medicine, we call them side effects, but it's still just a reaction. All right, then let's go to the next one. It secretes, the zona reticularis secretes the sex hormone, male sex hormones, androgens, in both males and females, both sexes. So this is where the women get testosterone from too. And it stimulates the protein metabolism and muscle buildup, and we call that anabolism. Remember, anabolic steroid. Anabolism is building it up. Catabolism is breaking things down. Kevin. Good. So that's all I got in my head. That's the outer shell of the adrenal gland. And then we go to the inner part, and that's the medulla. And that is closely related with the nervous system. Autonomic nervous system means automatic, means you don't think about it. Like you're breathing, you're that kind of stuff, the unconscious stuff. So it goes closely with that because the medulla is actually what secretes the adrenaline. So that's that hormone that you can feel when you get the jitters. That's an immediate stress hormone preparing the body for increased energy. So that's a good thing. So that's a short-term stress response. And if it stays too long, long-term, it becomes here. That's when we have the cortisol. That gets into the system. So in short stress response, the epinephrine. Long-term stress, cortisol. We're staying in stress all the time, we're going to go to the cortisol. That's why we're going to meditate. Or take a walk. Or try to relax, or whatever we want to do. But our environment does not really let us do that, so we have to like do it extra. It's like, you know, go to Hawaii or so, and you don't have to go to work, you go on vacation, you walk, everything is slow. That's probably when it's more balanced. The fast stuff, the energetic, fight or flighty stuff, and the relaxing stuff. All right. Let's see how many more we got. We still got a whole chapter. The pancreas. Who knows about the pancreas? The pancreas secretes insulin and glucagon. It secretes hormones that work with the glucose metabolism, hormones that work with bringing glucose into the system, bringing glucose into the blood. I mean, from the blood into the cell. So insulin brings the glucose from the bloodstream into the cell, and then when we don't have enough blood sugar in the bloodstream, we have another hormone that's known as glucagon, and glucagon dumps glucose into the bloodstream. It can make glucose, or it can break down glycogen. Remember glycogen, the molecules, the glucose molecules, one after the other, after the other, after the other, and we store that, the long chains of glucose, we store that in the liver. And we store that in the liver, and we store that some in the brain, and definitely in the muscles. And glucagon lets these be mobilized to dump into the bloodstream. So that's kind of cool. And then we can also, through that process, make more glucose from other molecules than from just carbohydrates. And we call that process gluconeogenesis. Neo from new, genesis from the genesis is the creation. Gluconeogenesis means you can take fat and make energy out of that. It's the energy metabolism. And glucose is just the easiest energy molecule. So what else we need to know about that? Oh, also the pancreas also secretes gastric juices into the small intestine. And that is a exocrine function because the intestine is part of the outside. It has a mouth and the butt. It's a tube. It has connections to the outside. So you do not secrete a hormone into that part of the outside. You secrete other stuff. And so from the pancreas, you know, sweat or sebum, sebaceous gland, from the pancreas is the gastric juices that go come from there. It's a very, very important gland.
Very important.
Look at that. It's that important. I have a big picture of it. I like that picture. We don't have to really go into detail with it because we see it again when we deal with the digestive system. We have a plaque where we see it. But, you know, I liked it for you. So we have parts here dump insulin and glucagon into the bloodstream, and they're both made by the same gland. And then over here, we have the digestive enzymes that dump the gastric juices into the small intestine, the first part of the small intestine. And I think that's the last slide of that. That's the gonads. Gonadal hormones serve the development of male and female sexual characteristics, growth, physical and emotional maturity, and reproduction, which is the generation of germ cells, the pregnancy, and the lactation. So they control a whole bunch of stuff. So we have estrogen and we have testosterone. Estrogen, look at the effects of estrogen. Helps maintain body temperature, delay memory loss, a whole bunch of good stuff too. But here in the ovaries, it helps the maturation of the ovaries. And then in the testicles, that helps the maturation of the testes. I mean, the testosterone helps the maturation of the testes. And it also has other stuff. Increased muscle mass, muscle strength, increased bone mass, stuff like that. You can read all the other details up. I don't have to rattle them off. But the function for us, the main part is it has to do with sexual characteristics and production of our offspring. Oh, and that's it. All right, let's see how you're doing.